following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
All right, welcome to what's today? Wednesday. I'm Nicole Sandler, coming to you live at nicolesandler.com/listen-live. That's sort of our home base. That's where you can get all of the different stream links. Still not streaming live on YouTube, thank you very much. But our suspension is up in a couple of weeks. In fact, 2 weeks. October 14th is the date. What else is going on? We're also on Twitch and Periscope and Facebook Live for the video streams, which today the sync is off again. So I'll go back to the old version, of course, of this software that I use, because the fix that I thought I had working didn't work exactly. So whatever, we'll deal with it today. Welcome to the show. So what did you do last night? I watched something that was billed as a debate between Joe Biden and the man pretending to be president. And oh my God, what a mess it was. Really, seriously, it was just horrible. I mean, and that was apparent within the first couple of minutes, because Donald Trump thinks the rules don't apply to him. That's all. He thinks the rules don't apply to him, that he's above it all. Whether the rules are talking about, you know, paying your taxes, or giving the other guy 2 minutes at the beginning of each segment to answer the question that was posed. The format of last night's debate ostensibly was supposed to work like this. There were going to be 5 or 6 different topics chosen by Chris Wallace, who really sucked as a moderator. And at the beginning of each segment, they were going to be asked a question. Each candidate was given 2 minutes to answer before being allowed to then follow up on, I guess, what the other guy said, and then have a freewheeling back and forth. None of those rules made any sense, because they didn't follow them, or more accurately, Donald Trump didn't follow them. It was a mess from the first word. And now, oh, this is interesting. Let me see if I can't find my notes. Apparently, the Commission on Presidential Debates has issued a statement saying they plan to issue strict new rules in the coming days that include cutting off a candidate's microphone if they violate the rules. So apparently we'll hear more about this change from the Presidential Debates Commission. A lot of people were saying that should be it. There really should not be another debate. If this is what we're going to be subjected to, no more. Let's not do it anymore. Apparently they're trying to fix it. I say apparently because I have no illusions that things are all of a sudden going to be better in the next debate. Now, the next week is the vice presidential debate. It's the one between Kamala Harris and Mike Pence, which should be something. That's a way to put it, right? Should be something. And then the following week is the second debate, ostensibly, between Biden and Trump. I have a hard time just getting the names out, because I still can't believe it's come to this. This is who we are, choosing between. Just astounding. But anyway, I digress. I wanted to play something for you. And in fact, I thought I saved the, I thought I pulled the video, but it seems like I pulled the wrong video. So let's start with, I don't know, what. First of all, let me throw open the phone lines. Should you care to weigh in on what happened last night, do feel free to call in. I'd love to get your thoughts. 954-889-6410 is the number. If you're on Skype, you can Skype in to Nicole Sandler. Just be aware, I have no producer. I have no call screener. So when you call, I take them as they come in. If I'm talking with someone, obviously wait till that person hangs up to call back, because I don't have a fancy schmancy phone system where I can put people on hold and, you know, and like that. So I take them as they come. If you want to weigh in, please do. I'm sort of vacillating between playing like the most disgusting example of what went wrong or going through what I have. And I guess maybe I should just go through what I have. We'll see. We'll play it by ear as the show goes on. So, you know, the best part about it was after the fact and flipping through the channels to see what some of the commentators, what their reaction was to the thing that I hate to call it a debate. And actually, out of all of them, Dana Bash of CNN hit the nail on the head. Here's what she said. Oops, it would help if I turned the pot up. Here's what she said.
That was a shit show.
That was a shit show. There was more to it than that, but that was the gist of it. It was a shit show. Here's what George Stephanopoulos on ABC said.
I have to speak personally here as somebody who's watched presidential debates for 40 years, as somebody who's moderated presidential debates, as someone who's prepared candidates for presidential debates, as someone who's covered presidential debates. That was the worst presidential debate I have ever seen in my life. A lot more heat than light over some 98 minutes.
Wow. The worst presidential debate I've ever seen. I'm looking for, okay, this is the Jake Tapper. So Dana Bash obviously is on CNN with Jake Tapper. Jake Tapper began the reaction to the debate. I mean, any channel you went to, it was this stunned look of sheer horror on the faces of all the people who were there to comment. Anyway, here's how Jake Tapper came out of the debate. What he said.
That was a hot mess inside a dumpster fire, inside a train wreck.
Okay.
That was the worst debate I have ever seen. In fact, it wasn't even a debate. It was a disgrace. And it's primarily because of President Trump.
Primarily.
Who spent the entire time not abiding by the rules that he agreed to, lying, maliciously attacking the son of the vice president. When asked to condemn white supremacists, he brought up the name of a neo-fascist far-right group and said, stand back and stand by. We'll talk about who won the debate, who lost the debate, but I can tell you one thing for sure. The American people lost.
The American people lost.
Because that was horrific.
Horrific!
You just took the words out of my mouth.
And here's Dana Bash.
You used some high-minded language. I'm just going to say it like it is. That was a shit show.
And that's where she said,
We're on cable. We can say that. Apologies for being maybe a little bit crude, but that is really the phrase that I'm getting more, you know, from people on both sides of the aisle on text. And it's the only phrase that I can think of to really describe it.
Shit show, indeed. Here's what Lester Holt, who's a bit more, you know, conservative, and he's on broadcast television, so he can't say shit show. Here's what he said.
If hearing that this debate is over was music to your ears, you may not be alone. What could have been a low point in American political discourse, certainly in any modern debate we've seen, just took place over an hour and a half. If you showed up looking for a food fight, you got a brawl between these two men, a language that we have rarely heard from candidates in a political debate. Name calling that went to a new level
yes.
frankly, Savannah Guthrie, I'm a bit at a loss for words here to describe what we've just witnessed.
Well, maybe because I think, like so many in this country watching this, your jaw just dropped. You can't pretend that this was a normal debate, a normal example of American democracy at work, a normal, you know, tussle between foes.
No, there was nothing normal about it. And then finally, I flipped over to MSNBC, where Nicole Wallace, with whom I have sort of a love-hate relationship, made a lot of sense.
I just want to give voice to what is probably an elephant in the room for those of you who have moderated debates. Chris Wallace did not act as a moderator. Mm-hmm. Donald Trump did not act as a debater.
Yeah.
Donald Trump was the abuser, and Chris Wallace was among the abused. Also among the abused, his opponent, who had a debate challenger who was cheating. I mean, those were not the rules. I participated in debate negotiations. There are rules. Donald Trump didn't follow them, and the debate moderator didn't hold his feet to the fire. And everyone who was suggesting, oh, there was nothing he could do, try driving down the freeway in a rainstorm with an 8-year-old in the back screaming. There's always something you can do. You take the iPad and you throw it out the window.
That's expensive. She's talking like a woman who has a, you know, Daily Show on network cable channel. Anyway, you know, Joe Biden, all he had to do was not screw up. All right, let's go to the phone, because you heard there's a phone call coming in. Hi, someone from the 503 area code. Who is this?
It's Steve.
Hi, Steve. Where are you calling from?
Hello?
Yeah.
Calling from Oregon.
Okay. Oh, okay, 503 area code. Yeah, so what's on your mind, Steve? Did you watch the debate last night?
I did, but I'm thinking you're deflating people from voting for Biden, the way you talk about it. Anytime you bring his name up.
Say that again?
I'm negative about it. It seems like every time you bring up Biden's name, you have to say something negative.
What did I say negative? What did I say negative about him?
When you mentioned the two candidates' names,
yeah,
you said you can't believe it's come to this.
Yeah, I can't believe it's come to this.
How many people did you just dissuade from voting?
I didn't dissuade anyone from voting. What, you're going to not vote for somebody because I said he's the less than the perfect candidate?
Well, how many Sanders people that agree with you are going to just sit at home?
None. Because they know, none, because they know the importance of getting Donald Trump the hell out of there. No one's going to not vote because I say Joe Biden is not the perfect candidate. That's a given. That's a known quantity. But you put him up next to Donald Trump and it's a no-brainer. What is your problem?
Well, stop putting him down. It's you and the Young Turks. They can't bring up his name without saying something.
Oh, my God. You know what? Screw you, buddy. I'm entitled to my opinion, and if you don't want to hear it, don't listen. Joe Biden is far from the perfect candidate, but I was about to say something really nice about him until Steve from Oregon called in to, what, yell at me for saying that Joe Biden's not perfect? If I said he was, you know I'd be lying. I don't lie. You may not like what I have to say, but I'll always be honest about my opinion. Would I rather it were somebody else running other than Joe Biden? Damn straight. Damn straight. But this is our choice. Joe Biden or Donald Trump. It's a no-brainer. I already voted for Joe Biden. Just waiting for my kid to come tomorrow, fill out her ballot, so we can drop all three of them off at the Supervisor of Elections office. Steve, go harass somebody else. Because I was about to say, as much of a shit show as it was last night, Joe Biden, actually, all he needed to do was not screw up. All he needed to do was just make it through, hold his own, and not make any horrific gaffes. Because Joe Biden is a gaffe machine. Sorry, Steve, even you have to admit that. But he did well. He did really well. In fact, there were moments when he was like, damn straight, you go. And there were a couple of times, there was one time in particular when Donald Trump kept interrupting him and mouthing off, and I screamed at the TV, shut the fuck up! And it was just a moment later, literally, someone's calling. All right. You're going to have to hold on a second, whoever this caller is. Hold on a second. It was just a moment later that Joe Biden said this.
The radical question, left.
Will you shut up, man?
Listen, who is on your list, Joe?
Well, you shut up, man. And it was the perfect retort. And in fact, it wasn't only that. Joe Biden had a few moments when he showed that he wasn't going to let this bully push him around.
Well, he's just shush for a minute. And you're the worst president America has ever had. Hey, come Joe, on. You've already fired most of them because they did a good job.
Some people don't well, do a good here's job. With you,
go ahead. You got the wait a minute. You get the final word. Minute.
Well, it's hard to get any word in with this clown. Excuse me. This.
Hey,
this
let me
person.
Just say that.
No. I'm Mr. President.
$3.5 million, Joe.
That is simply.
Why?
Okay, so it went like that. It was a shit show, but Joe Biden held his own, and actually, I was very impressed with him last night. Okay, now to the phones. Hi, who is this?
Hi, this is the mother from San Diego calling.
You're the mother of the young man who keeps calling me, who's a Republican. Got it. I got your message, and I want to tell you thank you. You left me a very nice message.
Oh, you're welcome. I love your show. I love your just everything about your show. Everything. So that's why he called. But he's not voting for Trump. Just so you know,
he's not.
So at least that's one less. No, he's not.
Is he voting for Biden, or is he not voting at all?
No. Well, he wants to vote for the Libertarian ticket, so I don't know, but at least that's one less vote for Trump. And
okay, baby steps.
He's seen some sanity with the whole COVID situation, so at least that's a plus. He actually came to calling him evil, so that was a big, big plus, yeah. And then what I wanted to say about last night's debate, it was like watching a toddler whining and trying to get attention while two grown-ups were trying to have a conversation. I mean, I felt the same way. I kept like, yo, turn around and just home. Like, shut up.
He finally said, well, you know, like, shut up, man. I was thrilled. It's like, yes, you go.
Yes,
and, you know, and today, of course, there are some, and I say some because not all of them, but some of, you know, the cable news pundits. Oh, they both did it. It was, you know, both of that. No, Joe Biden was reacting to the shit sandwich he was presented with.
Thank you. And he showed us how to be patient. I mean, I personally, I'm a total, like, Bernie, I'm a Bernie bro. Whatever.
Okay, me too. Me too.
But I love Bernie. That was my first choice. Joe Biden was not. But Joe Biden, to me, yesterday I was impressed too. I was impressed with his poise and how he carried himself and how he showed a maturity and a presidential attitude where you can have a debate without being vulgar. I mean, he called him a clown, but he presented himself as a clown. So I mean, he called it what it was.
Right. He deserved it. He had it coming. Absolutely.
Yeah. And he's lucky he didn't call him a mass murderer. I mean, come on. Star?
No,
really? You want to bring up Star?
Yep. No, I agree. I think Joe Biden showed a lot of restraint, but he got tough when he needed to. I thought he handled himself beautifully. And, you know, the whole thing about Donald Trump saying, I want to take a drug test. Well, if anyone was on drugs, boy, Donald Trump was either having a manic episode or he was hopped up on Adderall.
Something, but he was completely, did you see how much he, like, scowled?
Yes.
How like, off his game he was put, how much he kept rocking back and forth and grimacing. I mean, I just was like, wow, this guy got really exposed just for the childish little whiny brat. Like, I don't know if you've watched Willy Wonka, but he's like Baruch Hakone. I mean,
that's a good analogy. He was like a little kid who keeps, I want everything. Yeah. No.
I'm just totally disgusted. I can't believe that we're in this state. I just, every day I wake up and I feel like I'm in a nightmare and I'm going to wake up from it. And it's like, I just want Joe Biden to come back and just give us some sanity. I don't want to hear about what the president thinks every minute.
I don't want
to hear about his foul demeanor. Yeah. And then the fact that he's telling us to Proud Boys to stand by. He's telling us white supremacist militia that actually took sniper positions in Portland a few years ago.
Yes.
Do you remember that?
I do.
Positions. And they didn't even get in trouble. I mean, look at the fact that they murdered, not them, but the Boogaloo Boys, murdered two police officers in California. trying to blame it on the protest.
Well, they shot them. They didn't murder them, thankfully. Those two police officers are fine, and they're both out of the hospital. And they arrested somebody today.
No, not them.
Oh, not them. Somebody else.
No, not them. Before. No, in the early, in, I think it was June, in the early protest.
Okay.
The federal officer, Underwood.
Yeah.
And there was another sheriff's deputy that was shot and murdered. Both of them died. Remember, they kept bringing up Officer Underwood, because he was a federal agent who was also... He was black, and they kept bringing him up. The right kept bringing him up until it was found that the Boogaloo Boys did it. The guy who was the Army, he was like in the Air Force, I believe. But yeah, I mean, he hasn't denounced that. I've never heard a peep out of him over that. To condemn those groups.
Oh, never. Did you hear him today? So today, you know, he's got come under a lot of fire because Donald Trump last night would not condemn white supremacy. In fact, here, let me play this clip, because for those who didn't hear it last night, here's what happened.
Vice President Biden.
Oops, that's the wrong. Here it is.
But are you willing tonight to condemn white supremacists and militia groups and to say that they need to stand down and not add to the violence in a number of these cities, as we saw in Kenosha and as we've seen in Portland?
Sure,
are you
I'm willing to
specifically?
Do that, but I would say almost everything I see is from the left wing, not from the right wing.
So what are you saying?
I'm willing to do anything. I want to see peace.
Then do it, sir.
Say it. Do you want to call them... What do you want to call them? Give me a name.
White supremacists and white supremacists and right
Proud Boys. Stand back and stand by. But I'll tell you what. Somebody's got to do something about Antifa and the left, because this is not a right wing problem. This is a left
FBI director.
This is a left wing problem.
White supremacist. Antifa's an idea, not an organization.
Oh, you got it.
Not malicious. That's what FBI director
Gentlemen,
said.
Well, then you know what?
We're done, sir.
Everybody,
we're moving on to the next.
Woo! Okay. Oh, sorry, Mom. I realized you couldn't hear that because it's playing on the same pot on my board that you're coming up on. But that was the clip. So Donald Trump, first of all, sounded like he knew exactly who the Proud Boys were when Joe Biden brought up the name the Proud Boys. And then he said, sure, I'll tell them, stand back and stand by, which, hello. So he came under, obviously, a lot of fire for that, as he should have. So today, he's doing his chopper talk before he headed off on taxpayer expense to another campaign stop somewhere. And somebody asked him, one of the reporters asked him, again, you're not going to be able to hear this, but everyone else listening will, when he says, I don't know who the Proud Boys are. Again, it's Donald Trump lying.
I don't know who the Proud Boys are. I mean, you'll have to give me a definition, because I really don't know who they are.
Definition.
I can only say they have to stand down, let law enforcement do their work. Law enforcement will do the work more and more. As people see how bad this radical liberal Democrat movement is and how weak, the law enforcement's going to come back stronger and stronger. But again, I don't know who Proud Boys are, but whoever they are, they have to stand down, let law enforcement do their work.
So he said, yes, they have to stand down and let law enforcement do their work. And also, I don't know who the Proud Boys are. You're going to have to tell me. The man lies every time he opens his mouth.
Of course. So you should see the tweet that Marion Webster put out.
Oh, I love
it. But stand back and
yes,
stand by.
In fact, I retweeted it. And I put it, I have it here. They wrote, if I've got a whole bunch, now I can't find it. But yes, Merriam-Webster is one of the best. Here it is. Stand back to take a few steps backwards. Stand by to be or to get ready to act. Merriam-Webster
exactly.
is one
That's
of
That's what he wants.
Yep. Is one of the best Twitter
He wants to start
accounts.
A race war. He might as well be a boo-boo boy because he wants to start a race war.
That's
might
right.
as well be of a group study because he wants to start a race war because he can't get his weight. So I guess,
You're absolutely right. All right. I'm going to run because I got more stuff to play and you can't hear it when I play it down this line. So thank you for calling.
I love you. I love you.
What is your first name?
I go by the name Sandra.
Sandra. Okay. I just want to, I don't want to have to, I don't want to keep calling you Mom because,
Oh, you can call me Mom. That's fine,
too. Okay, Mom. That's Sandra, fine. Thank you for calling. And thanks, thanks for being diligent with your kid. I can only imagine. I can't imagine what I would do if my kid turned out to be a Republican. I don't think I can handle it.
Well, three out of four is not bad.
Oh, good.
Three
okay.
out of four are... like on the Bernie train, but they're on the Biden train now. So
okay, yeah. good to know. Thank you. Thank yeah. you, Mom. All right. You take care. Thanks
you
for
take
calling.
Care.
All right. Bye-bye. Bye. All right. So, yeah. So I love calls like that. She's so sweet. I feel terrible for her. Her son is, you know, I'm sure he's a nice, misguided kid, and he'll grow up one of these days, I hope. Anyway, back to the debate, such as it was. So that was the part I wanted to share with you. So when my favorite line of the whole thing was Joe Biden looking at Donald Trump and saying,
"Radical left, will you shut up, man?
Listen, who is on your list? Shut up, man. Shut up, man. Just shut up." In fact, I really, really wished, I mean, one song went through my head. You can imagine what it is, right? It's my new favorite song.
I just need you to shut the fuck up, because nobody asked you, bitch. I need you to shut the fuck up, bitch. Shut the fuck up, bitch. Just shut the fuck up, bitch. Shut the fuck up, bitch. Bow, bow, shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck up. Bow, bow, shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck up. Bow, bow, shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck up. Bow, bow.
Okay, so, but obviously, somebody did ask him, and that was his fucked up answer. So, our friend Lauren Mayer, she heard that, and she too was inspired. So take it away, Lauren Mayer. Will You Shut Up, Man, is the name.
Tonight's debate was frightening. And not the least bit enlightening. But Joe impressed with the best line of the night. Will you shut up, man? You're yapping. Normal debate rules, Trump's wrecking. Requiring full-time fact-checking. His interruptions Biden had to fight, saying, will you shut up, man, and stop flapping? I'm not sure why Chris Wallace didn't even try to moderate this unhinged nut. So lawless, while the other guy actually tried to debate. Trump made no sense, just loud noise and touting support for the Proud Boys. Oh, what the hell? It's like a skit on SNL. Joe said, will you shut up, man? Now he's scrapping. Trump spewed his rude word salad, but Biden laid out policies that were well thought out and valid. While while Trump ranted about planting a billion trees. Oh, please, I'm not sure this nonsense provided any help for the five voters who are still undecided. But we'll recall Joe spoke up for us all, saying, will you shut up, man? And we're clapping, saying, will you shut up, man? Man, we're clapping.
More Lauren Mayer. All right, we'll take a quick time out on the Progressive Voices Network. We'll be right back. She's just great. So turning that song around that fast, but taking some pleasure in with Joe's pushback on Donald Trump. Yes.
Radical left. Will you shut up, man? Listen, who is on your list, Joe?
Shut up, man.
Come on, man.
Yeah. All right. So let me tell you, while Progressive Voices is in a break, let me give you a little bit more of what went on. You know, one of the topics that was brought up was obviously COVID-19 and Donald Trump's horrible response to it. So Joe Biden actually did a good job of ignoring most of the idiocy that spewed from Trump's twisted mouth. He eviscerated Donald for his botched response to the pandemic, accusing him of panicking in the face of a historic public health crisis and hiding the threat from the American people. So Biden rattled through the devastating effects of COVID-19 in the United States and recalled Trump's dismissal of the toll in an August interview when he said this.
Vice President Biden, you have been much more reluctant than President Trump about reopening the economy and schools. Why, sir?
Because he doesn't have a plan. If I were running, I'd know what the plan is. You've got to provide these businesses the ability to have the money to be able to reopen with the PPE as well as with the sanitation they need. You have to provide them
plastic. Tell that to Nancy Pelosi.
Well, he's just shush for a minute.
Tell it to Nancy Pelosi and Schumer.
Nancy Pelosi and Schumer, they have a plan. He won't even meet with them. The Republicans won't meet with the Senate. And he sits on his golf course. Think about it.
You probably play more than I do, Joe.
What about this question of Rio?
You probably play more than I do, Joe. I thought that was the clip where he said, it is what it is. And Joe Biden called him out on that as well. But the other thing is that Donald Trump claimed, and this is a quote, there were no negative effects from his rallies. Really? No negative effects? Wait, here, I think this is the clip.
Your different approaches has even affected the way that you have campaigned. President Trump, you're holding large rallies with crowds packed together, thousands of people.
Outside,
yes, sir. Agreed.
Outside and inside.
Vice President Biden, you are holding much smaller events with...
Because nobody will show up.
People with...
God.
Nobody shows up to his rallies.
All right. In any case, why are you holding the big rallies? Why you not? You go first, sir.
Because people want to hear what I have to say. I mean,
but are you not worried about spreading disease?
As a president, and I'll have 35,000 people show up at airports. We use airports.
Are you not worried about the disease issue?
Are you not worried about disease?
So far, we have had no problem whatsoever.
Really?
It's outside. That's a big difference, according to the
experts. No problem whatsoever.
And we do them outside. We have tremendous crowds, as you see. I mean, every literally on 24 hours notice. And Joe does the circles and has three people someplace.
Okay.
By the way, did you see one of the last big rallies he has? And a reporter came up to him to ask him a question. He said, no. Stand back. Put on your mask.
Stand back.
Put on a mask. Have you been tested? I'm way far away from those other people. That's what he said. I can't. I'm going to be okay. He's not worried about you. He's not worried about the people out there breathing in one another.
We've had no negative effects.
We've had no negative effects. First of all, Joe Biden did a good job there. But what he didn't do was when right there at the end, before I cut it off, when Trump said, we've had no negative effects, can I ask Herman Cain if he feels the same way? Oh, wait. Yeah, Herman Cain is dead. Dead just a few short weeks after attending one of Trump's Nuremberg rallies and contracting COVID-19 and dying. So that happened. There's a whole bunch more. All right, I played for you already the part about where he wouldn't condemn the white supremacists. There was another really important part where Chris Wallace asked, will you not declare? Well, here's the question from Chris Wallace.
Will you urge your supporters to stay calm during this extended period, not to engage in any civil unrest? And will you pledge tonight that you will not declare victory until the election has been independently certified? President Trump, you go first.
I'm urging my supporters to go into the polls and watch very carefully, because that's what has to happen. I am urging them to do it. As you know, today there was a big problem. In Philadelphia, they went in to watch. They were called poll watchers, a very safe, very nice thing. They were thrown out. They weren't allowed to watch. You know why?
No, I know why.
Bad things happen
in
Philadelphia. Bad things. And I am urging my people. I hope it's going to be a fair election. If it's a fair election, I am 100% on board. But if I see tens of thousands of ballots being manipulated, I can't go along with that. And I'll tell you what, from a common sense,
does that mean you're going to tell your people to take to the
street? It means you have a fraudulent election.
Oh, please.
You're sending out 80 million ballots. They're not equipped to, these people aren't equipped to handle it, number one. Number two, they cheat.
They cheat. That's projection. Because Trump is the one who cheats. Period. End of statement. And as for the poll watchers, I've been a poll watcher. I was a poll watcher back in 2004. Remember that election, John Kerry against George W. Bush? I went as a poll watcher. You have to sign up in advance, and each state has different regulations governing poll watchers, governing what happens at the polls. So I went to the NCSL website, which is the National Conference of State Legislatures, and there's a section on poll watcher qualifications, go figure, and it has every state broken out. And so he mentioned Philadelphia. So I go down to Pennsylvania, and here's what it says. To be a poll watcher in Pennsylvania, must be a registered voter in the county, can only be a poll watcher in one district. Candidates can appoint two watchers per district, and political parties can appoint three watchers per district. What it doesn't say, excuse me, on here is that in Pennsylvania, they only allow poll watchers on election day. On election day, not for early voting, so again, each state has their regulations. And if you follow the regulations, chances are in any given state, they can only go on election day, or they have to be appointed by a candidate or by the political party. And there's a limit on how many there can be. It's usually one or two from each party, not a crowd of, you know, thousands or hundreds or even dozens of, you know, Proud Boys. That's not how it works. And here, let me look at Florida, just because that's where I'm sitting. And it says, a qualified and registered elector in the county in which he/she will serve, one per party and one per candidate, cannot be a candidate or law enforcement officer. As a poll watcher, you can't have a law enforcement officer, which Donald Trump threatened to do. Must wear a badge identifying them by name. There are other rules, and let me see if I can find it. The overview, it says the table below lists state-by-state laws regarding poll watchers, also known as partisan citizen observers. I'm trying to find it. Maybe it wasn't in this overview, but in a number of states, you can't be armed. you can't be a candidate. And actually, it seems like West Virginia appears to be the only state that does not allow poll watchers to observe elections. But as with everything else, there are regulations that govern how the process works. You can't just show up in a gang, a militia, and say, we're here to be poll watchers. It doesn't work that way. But Donald Trump doesn't understand rules and regulations. Yeah, that's a problem. You know, I have an interview to air, but, you know, I don't know. I guess we should keep going. I should leave it up to you guys. What should we do? Should we hear the interview with Jennifer Taub about big, dirty money? Or should we keep going through some of the insanity from the debate last night? So I'm watching on at NicoleSandler.com. The chat room and the listen live page. I'm watching on Twitch, where we have where someone, Dead Keith the Frozen, says I've had enough of Trump, the Facebook group. So you know what? I'm over. I'd be running late if I were to air the interview now. So I think I'm going to hold on to this and keep going, because there was more. I guess where should we go next? I should stick to my script. So I have what I'm telling you about. I've got a bunch of other things. Okay, so let me share this part. I told you, played the part about Donald Trump saying he's calling up his minions to go to the polls for poll watching. And I guess that U.S. national security officials are also gearing up to deal with Trump's directives to his supporters that they should go out to the polls. Because in recent memos, U.S. national security officials from both the Department of Homeland Security and the FBI have warned that violent domestic extremists could threaten the fall presidential election. Homeland Security officials have said political tensions, civil unrest, and foreign disinformation campaigns were creating a toxic environment that could erupt in violence. Last week, Trump twice declined to commit to a peaceful transfer of power should he lose to Joe Biden. And then he leveled baseless accusations that Democrats are trying to steal the election with fraudulent heavy mail-in balloting. There's nothing fraudulent about mail-in voting. There is no evidence, just Donald Trump lies about every goddamn thing. You know, on the subject of the mail-in ballots, did you hear this one? This was one of his whoppers from last night.
What's going on? Take a look at West Virginia. Mailmen selling the ballots.
What?
They're being sold. They're being dumped in rivers.
What?
This is a horrible thing for our country.
There is no,
this is not.
There is no.
This is not going to end well.
There is okay. No
this is not
Vice,
going
Vice
to
President
end well.
Five states in fact, have had mail-in ballots.
There's no evidence of that. Thank you again, Joe Biden, for speaking up. There is no evidence of that. And then, so that happened, right? And in this other, these are a couple of clips that stood out to me because I'm hoping some journalists follow up on them. Really? Mailmen selling ballots? Prove it. This is going to be the retort to everything Donald Trump says from here on out. Prove it. Show us the receipts. This is a particularly good one because in this one, Donald Trump claims that he has tapes of Joe Biden attempting a coup? See if you can figure out what he's trying to say here.
So when I listened to Joe talking about a transition, there's been no transition from
no,
when
because
I won.
You're
I won
still
that election.
The president,
and
you
if
idiot.
You look at crooked Hillary Clinton, if you look at all of the different people, there was no transition because they came after me trying to do a coup. They came after me spying on my campaign.
Oh
they started
God.
From the day I won and even before I won, from the day I came down the escalator with our first lady. They were a disaster. They were a disgrace to our country.
Oh my
and we've
God.
Caught them. We've caught them
what?
All. We've got it all on tape. We've caught them all. And by the way, you gave the idea for the Logan Act against General Flynn. You better take
what?
A look at that because we caught you in a sense and President Obama was sitting in the office. He knew about it, too. So don't tell me about a free transition. As far as the ballots are concerned, it's a disaster. A solicited ballot Okay, solicit it is okay.
Oh my
you're
God.
Soliciting, you're asking, they send it back, you send it back. I did that. If you have an unsolicited, they're sending millions of ballots all over.
Okay. That's what we have to do. You know, we just have to laugh. He's insane. And I guess it's not nice to laugh at people who are mentally ill, but he's fucking insane. I want to know what he's accusing. His tape of Joe Biden doing what? Please, somebody follow up on that. Or just tell him to...
The radical question, left.
Will you shut up, man?
Listen, who is on your list? Who is on your
shut up, man. All right, there's more. You know, climate change was a topic that was brought up, and Donald Trump really brought the crazy on that one. You thought he was done with his raking the forest floors nonsense, didn't you?
I'd like to talk about climate change.
So would I.
The forest fires in the West are raging now. They have burned millions of acres. They have displaced hundreds of thousands of people. When state officials there blame the fires on climate change, Mr. President, you said, I don't think the science knows. Over your 4 years, you have pulled the U.S. out of the Paris Climate Accord. You have rolled back a number of Obama environmental records. What do you believe about the science of climate change, and what will you do in the next 4 years to confront it?
I want crystal clean water and air. I want beautiful, clean air. We have now the lowest carbon. If you look our numbers right now, we are doing phenomenally.
Oh, my God.
But I haven't destroyed our business.
I got to tell you, I'm not playing video of this because to get all the video clips, it was just too much. But if you can find the video of this clip where Donald Trump goes off on this tangent. I want clean air, the cleanest air, the cleanest water. Joe Biden's face just says it all. Find it. If you're on Twitter, go follow Aaron Rupar, ATRUPAR is his Twitter handle. He works for Vox, and he is the king of pulling video clips. He's great. And I think he labeled that one, this is where Joe Biden's soul left his body or something like that. It was classic. But you can imagine, just, you know, look in the mirror and see the expressions you make listening to this load of shit.
Our businesses. Our businesses aren't put out of commission. If you look at the Paris Accord, it was a disaster from our standpoint. And people very happy about what's going on. Because our businesses are doing well. As far as the fires are concerned,
Here we go.
Need forest management
in addition
to everything else. The forest floors are loaded up with trees, dead trees that are years old, and they're like tinder, and leaves and everything else. You drop a cigarette in there, the whole forest burns down. You've got to have forest management.
You got to have forest management. He continued.
Europe live their forest cities.
In Europe. Cities. It's not
they
Europe.
They maintain their forests. They manage their forests. I was with the head of a major country. It's a forest city.
A country or a city?
Trees that are far more, they ignite much easier than California. There shouldn't be that problem. I spoke with the governor about it. I'm getting along very well with the governor. But I said, you know, at some point, you can't every year have hundreds of thousands of acres of land just burned to the ground.
But sir,
you can't do what? Oh my God. Really. The crazy was out in force. And yes, I'm seeing Francie in the Twitch chat room. Chris Wallace really sucked out loud. He was just so bad. You know, I've got some other clips. At one point, Chris Wallace actually did something good. He asked a really good question with a fascinating fact that directly contradicts Donald Trump's lies about the economy. He keeps saying, well, I built the best economy in American history. Bullshit. It is, in fact,
come on, man.
It is complete and utter bullshit. It's not by far, not even close to the best economy ever. And then Chris Wallace hit him with this factoid.
In Obama's, you talk about the economy booming. It turns out that in Obama's final 3 years as president, more jobs were created, 1.5 million more jobs than in the first 3 years of your presidency.
They had the slowest recovery since 19 economic recovery since 1929. It was the slowest recovery. Also, they took over something that was down here. All you had to do is turn on the lights and you pick up a lot. But they had the slowest economic recovery since 1929. Let me tell you about the stock market. When the stock market goes up, that means jobs. It also means 401ks. If you got in, if you ever became president with your ideas, you want to terminate my taxes, I'll tell you what, you'll lose half of the companies that have poured in here will leave, and plenty of companies that are already here, they'll leave for other places. They will leave, and you will have a depression, the likes of which you've never seen.
Look. There he goes, the likes of which you've never seen. He's talking out of his ass. He doesn't have a clue. And then there was the subject of race. Can't go without dealing with this. And again, Chris Wallace, I'll give him a couple of props for some decent questions, a few. And this one about ending racial sensitivity training. You know, I talk about opposite world all the time. This is a prime example.
Your administration directed federal agencies to end racial sensitivity training that addresses white privilege or critical race theory. Why did you decide to do that, to end racial sensitivity training? And do you believe that there is systemic racism in this country, sir?
I ended it because it's racist. I ended it because a lot of people were
racist.
Complaining that they were asked to do things that were absolutely insane, that it was a radical revolution that was taking place in our military, in our schools, all over the place, and you know it, and so does everybody else.
He does that all the time. You know it.
Racial sensitivity.
So does everybody else.
If you were a certain person, you had no status in life. It was sort of a reversal.
Yeah.
And if you look at the people, we were paying people hundreds of thousands of dollars to teach very bad ideas and, frankly, very sick ideas.
Yeah, to teach about the 1619 Project.
They were teaching people to hate our country.
No, they were teaching history.
I'm not going to allow that to happen. We have to go back to the core values of this country. They were teaching people that our country is a horrible place, it's a racist place, and they were teaching people to hate our country.
No, Donald, they were teaching American history. We have a 400-year history of slavery where people were treated like prattle, where people were owned and bought and sold and brutalized. That's truth. You can't rewrite history as much as you try. And as for racists, that would be you, you piece of shit. Can we talk about calling for the death sentence for the Central Park Five even after it was proven they were innocent? You still called for the death penalty for them. You are a racist. So when Chris Wallace asked, why should we trust you to deal with race issues? Remember, that was the question here. Why should we trust you to deal with race issues? And listen to his answer.
That as far as the church is concerned, and as far as the generals are concerned, we just got the support of 250 military leaders and generals. Total support. Law enforcement, almost every law enforcement group in the United States. I have Florida, I have Texas, I have Ohio, I have Portland. The sheriff just came out today and he said I support President Trump.
Okay, that was, I know it seems like I played the wrong clip. The question was, why should we trust you to deal with race issues? And he talked about his great support from law enforcement. And by the way, the sheriff of Portland, Oregon tweeted out, I did no such thing. I do not support this man. He is a liar. Liar. Okay, but there's one more clip that I've saved. And this is where this was the first topic or the second topic, I think, they dealt with. And it just shows why Dana Bash called it a shit show. I'll probably interrupt it. It's a long clip. But you'll see why I think it started out, the debate started out with the highest number of viewers, I think, ever watching a presidential debate. And it quickly dwindled down to nothing, to anemic numbers, because people couldn't stand watching this crap. Here's a little bit of what happened.
Points out that you would like to add a public option to Obamacare.
Oh, I didn't love Joe Biden's answer on this one.
And other Republicans make is that that is going to end private insurance.
It is not.
And well, if I can ask you the question, it will end.
Not what your party says, by the way.
It will end private insurance and create a government takeover of health care.
It does not. It's only for those people who are so poor they qualify for Medicaid.
No, it isn't, Joe Biden.
They can get that free in most states, except governors who want to deny people who are poor Medicaid. Anyone who qualifies for Medicare would, Medicaid would automatically be enrolled in the public option. The vast majority of the American people would still not be in that option. Number one.
Joe, you agreed with Bernie Sanders.
And then you hear him cut him off.
On the manifesto,
manifesto.
And that gives you socialized medicine.
Look, hey, I'm not going to listen to him. The fact of the matter is, I beat Bernie Sanders.
Not by much.
I beat him a whole hell of a lot. I'm here standing facing
Pocahontas
you all, buddy.
Pocahontas would have left 2 days early. You would have lost every primary.
All he knows how to do is hurt.
Tuesday. You got very lucky.
Here's the deal. I got very lucky. I mean, you're very lucky tonight as well. And tonight I'm going to make sure because here's the deal.
Here's the deal.
The fact is that everything he's saying so far is simply a lie. I'm not here to call out his lies. Everybody knows he's a liar.
But you
I just want to make sure.
Joe, you're the liar.
I want to make sure.
You graduated last in your class, not first in your class.
Oh, my God.
I want to make sure.
Mr. President, can you let him finish, sir?
Please.
He doesn't know how to do that. He has,
surprised.
You pick
Go
the wrong
ahead,
guy, the wrong night at the wrong time.
Listen, you agreed with Bernie Sanders to the manifesto.
The whole idea, there is no manifesto, number
Please
one.
Please let him speak, Mr. President.
Number two.
You just lost the left.
Number two.
you just lost the left. You agreed with Bernie Sanders on a plan.
Why he's letting him talk, I don't know.
Do you have any idea what this clown's doing?
Socialized medicine.
Mr. President.
I'll tell you what. He is not for any help for people needing health care. In fact, already has cost 10 million people their health care that they had from their employers because of his recession. Number one. There are 20 million people getting health care through Obamacare now that he wants to take it away.
Yep.
He won't ever look you in the eye and say that's what he wants to do. Take it away.
No, I want to give
number
him better health care at a much lower price.
And by the way, he doesn't know how. He doesn't know how
I've
to do that.
I've already fixed it.
He has never
I've
offered a plan.
Fixed it to an extent.
He has never done a single thing.
No, but probably does.
Gentlemen, you realize if you're both speaking at the same time.
And it's still
go ahead, sir.
Obamacare is no good. We made it better. And I had a choice to make very early on. We took away the individual mandate.
That was a shit show.
Pre-existing conditions, but took away the individual mandate. Listen, this is the way it is. And that destroyed, that they shouldn't even call it Obamacare. Then I had a choice to make.
Do
I let my people run it really well?
Oh, my God. He's delusional.
Or badly.
If
I run it badly,
they'll
probably blame him, but they'll blame me. But more importantly, I want to help people. Okay?
Oh, please.
I said, you got to run it so well.
That's what
And I just had a meeting with them. They said,
with
the problem is no matter how well
who
you run Obamacare, it's a disaster. It's too expensive.
Okay.
Premiums are too high,
that's
and it doesn't work. So we do want to get rid of it.
Oh my God!
We want to get rid of it.
I understand it, sir, but I have to give you roughly equal time.
Good.
Please,
please,
let the vice president
shut
talk.
Up.
He has no plan for health care.
Thank you.
Yes, we do.
He
sends out wishful thinking. He has executive orders that have no power. He hasn't lowered drug costs for anybody. He's been promising a health care plan since he got elected. He has none, like almost everything else he talks about. He does not have a plan. He doesn't have a plan. And the fact is, this man doesn't know what he's talking about.
All right, I have one final question for you.
Sure.
He didn't give him enough time. If Senate Republicans, we were talking originally about the Supreme Court
here. Yes, they were.
If Senate Republicans go ahead and confirm Justice Barrett, there has been talk about ending the filibuster or even packing the court, adding to the 9 justices there. You call this a distraction by the president, but in fact, it wasn't brought up by the president. It was brought up by some of your Democratic colleagues in the Congress. So my question to you is, you have refused in the past to talk about it. Are you willing to tell the American people tonight whether or not you will support either ending the filibuster or packing the court?
Whatever position I take in that, that'll become the issue. The issue is the American people should speak. You should go out and vote.
You're in voting now. Vote and let your senators know how strongly you feel. Vote now.
Are you going to pack the
make
court?
Sure you
shut up,
fact,
Donald.
Let people know.
He doesn't want
you're
to
a senator.
Question.
I'm not going to answer the question.
Why
because,
would you answer that
because
question?
Because the question is, the question is,
the radical left.
Will you shut up, man?
Listen, who is on
will
your
you
list,
shut
Joe?
Up, man?
This is on
so
your list.
Gentlemen, I think
this is so unprecedented.
He's going to pack the court.
We're
not going to give a list.
We have ended this segment. We're going to move on to the second segment.
That was really a productive segment, wasn't it?
Yeah. About as productive as the entire so-called debate. Thanks for listening, everyone. I'll see you tomorrow. Good luck to us all.